Poor Ant-Man, he's always one step behind the Avengers, but hey, at least this time he's not alone. Ant-Man and the Wasp is the sequel to 2015's Ant-Man, once again directed by Peyton Reed, and is the 20th film in the Marvel Cinematic Universe. Yes, 10 years later, and they've hit that big 2-0. So this movie takes place sometime after Captain America Civil War, where Scott Lang, once again played by Paul Rudd, is under house arrest, but he is soon recruited once again by Hope Van Dyne, played by Evangeline Lilly, and Hank Pym, played by Michael Douglas. Because of Scott's visit to the Quantum Zone in the last movie, he started getting visions of Janet Van Dyne, who's Hope's mother and Hank's wife, and they basically try to use Scott to try to figure out a way to get into the Quantum Zone and get Janet back. But they also have to deal with a couple of villains, one of which has the ability to teleport around and basically shift herself due to an accident back in the past. So Marvel has just definitely been on a roll this year. I mean, with Phase 3 in general, but this year alone, they gave us Black Panther, which is one of the best superhero movies ever, and then Infinity War, which, again, one of the best superhero movies ever. Black Panther is more culturally significant, but Infinity War was more of an accomplishment due to its ambition, and just to prove to everyone that these movies aren't all fun and games. So with Ant-Man and the Wasp, it is nice to kind of cool down, get something a little more lighthearted, a little more fun, and go back to a simpler time before this happened. And while Ant-Man and the Wasp is not as good as those two movies, I mean, I didn't think anybody was expecting it to be as good as those two, I like this more than the first Ant-Man. I rewatched the first Ant-Man just yesterday in prep for this movie, and I actually liked it a lot better the second time around, because the idea of all the production trouble and then getting rid of Edgar Wright was out the window. I just enjoyed it for what it was, and I definitely liked it a lot. This I like a lot better due to one element that I've been looking forward to for some time, the Wasp. Even though it's not actually Janet Van Dyne, I am so glad to see them finally give the character of the Wasp her due. Because whenever I think of Ant-Man or the Wasp, it's really hard for me to think of one without the other, because they're one of the best Marvel dynamic duos out there. And it's also very important to note, and this is one thing the movie gets right, they acknowledge that Hope is a partner, not a sidekick. Wasp is never Ant-Man's sidekick. The two of them are partners, and I think the chemistry between them, especially during the action scenes, works very well. Anytime Hope is in the Wasp suit kicking all kinds of ass, I was enjoying it. Those were the big highlights of the movie for me, and there were points where I was a little disappointed whenever she was not fighting. But that's not to say the rest of the movie is bad. There's a lot of other good things in this movie that I like, some of which carry in from the first Ant-Man. There's a lot of cool ideas they come up with in terms of the shrinking tech, and they really get inventive with all these ideas and just go full force. And because of all the inventive ideas that this movie does with the shrinking and growing tech, it leads into a lot of funny moments throughout the movie. And this movie is funny, just like the first Ant-Man was. Some of the jokes don't really hit all the time. For example, there are a few moments with Michael Peña where it just feels like he's doing a stand-up routine. And Michael Peña, when used right, is funny, just like in the first Ant-Man and most of this one, but there are a few points where his comedy was a little too much, didn't really have anything to do with the plot, and you just kind of want to wrap it up. The best comedic moments, like I mentioned, have to do whenever they're utilizing the growing tech or shrinking tech. There's a great running joke with Scott Lang and his suit that I'm not going to say. I'll just let you guys see the movie and have it speak for itself. But ultimately, it's very, very funny. Sometimes I laughed a little too hard, and that might be because Infinity War was such a downer that I needed to laugh hard at something in the MCU, so still funny, but I'm just wondering, were they really worth laughing that hard for me? Maybe. There's also one element that I really do like, and that's the fate of the world's not at risk. Just like with the first Ant-Man and Spider-Man Homecoming, the fate of the universe is not at stake with this one, and it's a more condensed story. And in ways, it's kind of a personal story because it does ultimately have to deal with a parent's relationship with their child or daughter in both cases, with Scott Lang and his daughter, and then with the entire group trying to find Janet Van Dyne, who's played by Michelle Pfeiffer, and bring her back into the real world. I think it does have a very heartfelt look into the daughter and parent relationship. So I don't have a whole lot to say about Ant-Man and the Wasp because I just didn't think it blew my mind the way Black Panther and Infinity War did. If you ultimately like the first Ant-Man, you're really gonna like this one, probably even more. And if I had any negatives to say, I'd probably point to the villains. Now, this is not Marvel going back down the realm of, oh, they can't do villains right. Don't get that idea in your head. So let's talk about the main villain, or the one that's been marketed a lot. Ghost. In this movie, Ghost is played by Hannah John-Kamen, who we last saw as Ben Mendelsohn's henchman in Ready Player One. And the problem with her isn't the fact that she doesn't hold a candle to Killmonger or Thanos. We all knew she wouldn't. But she's not really made to be a villain, which in a way is not a bad thing because there is a little bit of sympathy with her character because we get a backstory with her, we know why she's doing what she's doing, and she's just going to great lengths to accomplish her goals and just get the job done. But again, she's just not as charismatic as the other two villains as I mentioned. Your actual villain in the movie is played by Walton Goggins, who, I gotta say right now, this movie utilizes his charisma and talent a lot more than Tomb Raider did, because in Tomb Raider he was boring. You don't make somebody like Walton Goggins boring. And this movie, while in terms of charisma didn't make him boring, he's not a very good villain. He reminds me very much of the Sovereign Race from Guardians of the Galaxy Volume 2. You know, the Golden People. If you took his character out of the movie, then I don't think it would have really affected anything. It would not have changed the course of the film at all. But on the whole, Ant-Man and the Wasp is a ton of fun. Again, it's not as good as Black Panther or Infinity War, but this is a nice little way for Marvel to round up their year, and I'd ultimately say it's good. It's not great by any stretch of the imagination, but I still like this better than the first Ant-Man. It's definitely a ton of fun, and if you were really down and depressed by the end of Infinity War, then this will lift your spirits up a little bit. A little bit. And that's my review for Ant-Man and the Wasp. I hope you enjoyed it. Leave a comment down below and tell me what your thoughts are on the movie, if and when you've seen it. Don't forget to support my Patreon page, follow me on social media, and until next time, this is the real Mr. Robinson telling you there's only one.